Hello. Good afternoon, everybody. We are like rock stars. This is the panel to be attended on diversity of business model. I'm Rémi Laurent, Semtech. I'm a director for LoRaWAN Networks and chairing the LoRa Alliance operator community. Happy to moderate this panel that has one of the largest geographical diversity. We're gonna feature really leading companies of the ecosystem, and I just need to be able to switch, guys. So
it's all good.
I need some help.
It's okay.
That's just to switch the slides.
It's okay now.
That's okay, okay. So today, guys, we're gonna feature Mr. Olivier Hersent, Actility. I will let you introduce yourself.
I was the founder of Actility and the CEO managing technology.
Mr. Dave Chandal, Senet, US.
Thank you, Rémi. Dave Chandal, Chief Technology Officer at Senet.
Mr. Ali Hosseini, India.
Yeah, I think he basically introduced me. No, I'm Ali Hosseini, CEO, founder of Senra, for an IoT network operator in India.
Hey, I'm
Joey Miller, yes?
Yeah, Joey Miller, I'm technical director of the Helium Foundation.
Daniel Lapper, coming from Brazil.
I'm Daniel Lapper from American Tower. I'm senior director of 5 million new business developing in Brazil, in charge of our mutual host IoT network.
Rob Zagavella, coming not from Sicily, but from Australia. He has some origin.
Rob Zagavella, co-founder and CEO of NNNCo. Great to be here.
And Tom Nelson, Everynet from the US.
Thank you. Tom Nelson, Chief Marketing Officer with Everynet, Kansas City, USA.
Okay. So guys, it's going to be a 45-minute panel split into 30 minutes talk. And I propose to walk you through the story of LoRaWAN Networks. The goal is to show the unique capability of LoRaWAN to deliver diverse business model. It solves problems that the massive IoT market has. It's probably unique on the market, and we want to show you how it will bring a sustainable value to the business in the coming years and centuries, I hope. So, let me walk you through. Next slide, please. So, it's not by surprise that we have this panel today on business model diversity. It was designed from the ground up. 7 years ago, when we built LoRaWAN, that was our intention to show these business model diversities, because we noticed that on the market, it was not present. Why? Because it's an open, standard, and large ecosystem. We are a ITU standard now. Next, it's easy to deploy. You do not need to have a licensed spectrum. You do not need to invest from day one billions of dollars. It is accessible to tier one, tier two, tier three, developer, community, and it's a democratized standard. It's an open mindset, like an open standard. We are able to interconnect with other standards. There are some works with a DLMS, OMS, GS1, and we are able to use multi-radio access network technology. And we have a global footprint in 200 plus countries. This business model flexibility is not for fun. It increases the customer options. You can do anything, make or buy, CapEx, OpEx. You choose your quality of service scheme. You choose your operating option. You may want to deploy a network on a city. on the region, on the country, on multi-country, and across the world. And we will leverage that. And you will see today that our seven panelists already implement all these business models. Next slide, please. Let me walk you through this LoRaWAN Network story. Like I said, we clearly adapt to all IoT use cases thanks to this business model diversity. That's the first driver. The second driver is that this business model diversity is making the difference. Some other technologies, for instance, are focused on operator business model. LoRaWAN can set up any type of business model. And this diversity brings a sustainability for the coming years. Imagine that having a licensed spectrum is only affordable by 1,000 companies in the world. In the LoRaWAN world, it's 10x, it's 20x the number of companies that can access to the technology. And at the end of the day, if one of the players is stepping down, there is no impact for the whole ecosystem. So it is a sustainable ecosystem. Starting 7 years ago, the first network to be deployed was the private network, because it was do-it-yourself, easy to access, to deploy at your campus. We have today thousands of private networks in 200 countries. So maybe, Olivier, you want to expand and share with us, because Actility is a key global integrator for private network, but not also, and maybe you want to develop this type of networks.
Yeah, private networks is aggregate for vast diversity of use cases itself. Maybe some of you attended the presentation by Mike Hartree from Cisco earlier, presenting what they do for State Department, US Army. As you can guess, this type of segment, the data just stays in the bubble, the specific security tier, GovCloud, for example, for the US. So that's a typical example of a private network that is constrained by primarily a security view. We find lots of private networks in the industry as well. Particularly, you know, the dichotomy between IT world and OT. The OT bubble is typically intra-enterprise. There are very, very few enterprises that have, you use protocols like Modbus internally to the enterprise. Very few of the enterprises would let the data out for whatever concerns the production environment. So also in that case, whenever you want to run LoRaWAN to monitor pipe temperature, to monitor leaks, these kind of things, I refer you to the presentation of Total earlier, presenting how they do it for oil and gas. You also need private networks, mostly because of to avoid dependence on third parties. You know, they want to be completely autonomous for what relates to autonomy, functioning of the network. And then, unfortunately, diversity means headaches for engineers, because you get mix and match. Many enterprises, utilities, they want to get private networks at some places, but the sum of all private networks needs to behave as a single network. You can achieve this through roaming. So, I would say private is about half to 60% of the network, of the market.
Okay, so private network is not a question, it's skyrocketing. So now let's move in the 2010. Once upon a time in 2010, some operator decided to make this LoRaWAN standard a public network standard. Senet was probably the first to develop this business model with European mobile network operators like Orange, like KPN at that time, and Swisscom. And Senet did more than that, because we are talking business model, guys. They developed a kind of innovative LoRaWAN virtual network approach, connecting on the same marketplace, solution provider, public operator, and also managing the end-to-end value chain, including billing. Maybe you want to develop that. What you've been doing, how you felt being the first also to set up this public network in the US.
Yeah, thank you, Remy. So certainly, first of those towers went up just a few months before the first LoRa Alliance founding meeting and Mobile World Congress in 2015. So yeah, it's been quite a long time. And over that time, there has been, we've observed this diversity of business models that then translates into a diversity of network deployments. We see very strongly, as Olivier said, there are these real private enclaves that are truly isolated from everything else. But as we move beyond that, we still see customers who desire to control their own deployment destiny by deploying their own gateways. And sometimes they want to apply restrictions to that as well, that those gateways are only used for their devices, for their applications. Sometimes they're more open to that. So one of the things that Senet has developed over that time is the ability to very easily opt in and out of a hybrid network that contains both the public network that Senet deploys and some of our partners deploy, as well as the enterprise and private style networks that our solution providers are deploying. And that ability to make that decision later in the deployment lifecycle is also very powerful. So a lot of times we will see that our customers will have initial hesitation to contribute to to our virtual network. But over time, they see the benefit of both opening their networks, which means that other third-party applications can easily attach and grow, as well as opening their devices to the broader public network. And this is particularly true as we see that collaborative network growing with other partners in the space and other technologies.
So what is fantastic, Dave, with this business model, it was a game changer in the sense that, remember, historically, you build a public network and your customers are enterprises. So now you get a step forward. Your customer can be enterprises, operators, solution providers, cities, communities, and it makes me move to Brazil, to American Tower do Brasil. What you did with Everynet, it's what you name a wholesale model. You kind of develop also a model where you can enable this diversity of customer, diversity of business model, diversity of customers. Can you tell us more about that?
Yes, sure. Yes. American Tower is, of course, a company of towers, mostly towers. But above all, we are a company of shared infrastructure. So we understand that sharing of infrastructure is important for the telecommunication development. So back in 2017, we were looking to the IoT market and we saw that mostly connections of IoT in Brazil were about M2M SIM cards. And there was some emerging technologies such as LoRaWAN that were not present. And we talked to them, the MNOs, operators, the telco players, and they were not intending to deploy a network on such technology. And we saw that being a shared infrastructure company, we could deploy a shared infrastructure, a shared neutral host network in LoRaWAN that could be used for different MNOs and telco players as a whole. We call it then LVNOs, LoRaWAN Virtual Network Operators, that they can use this shared infrastructure so they don't need to worry about deploying the network and they can focus on the deployment and the sale of the network itself, the deployment of the use case. So sometimes now it's called NAS, Network as a Service, RAN and Radio Access Network as a Service. We understand that's quite efficient for some reasons. First of all, it's very efficient because you don't need to worry about the CapEx. So for our customers, it's basically CapEx free and it's very low cost. So you don't need to worry about it. It's national. We can expand this to the whole country. Today we are about 200 cities, about 110 million people cover it. It's very flexible. We can expand this the way we want. The customers can expand the coverage if they want us to buy gateways and connecting our network. And it's also carrier grade. So it's very important for the long term that the infrastructure be very robust to enable the use case on the long term, even because it's one of the value propositions of LoRaWAN. So we see that it's a good model and it has been quite well used.
Okay, so hearing from you, stepping back, I think that there are two problems to be solved by a public operator or by a network provider. First, building the network. It's mostly a CapEx problem, and OPEX as well. And second, grow the ecosystem. And it is well illustrated by the partnership between American Tower do Brasil and Everynet, both complementing. And Tom, it was such a success that you made it a global story in multiple countries. Can you share how you scaled it, how you replicated it, and what was the benefit, in fact, for you on a global scale?
Sure. So, first of all, hands off to American Tower and Daniel building out the fifth largest population in the world, Brazil. And so we had a lot of learnings in Brazil, and we think about the learnings that we had in Brazil. One is building a resilient network, and thinking about the rainfall in Brazil, the lightning strikes, the power supplies, the backup, the industrial grade infrastructure that we put in Brazil, because what we heard from our customers is they wanted an enterprise grade, carrier grade level of a network for LoRaWAN that they could put their operations and billing and other operations on top of and feel comfortable that all these different massive IoT applications would be secure and that would be low cost with zero CapEx. So we tried to make IoT and LoRaWAN easy to consume so that we could enable massive markets. And so part of our work in Brazil was also developing the ecosystem. So inviting global solutions partners and players into Brazil, and then also working with American Tower to do localized workshops so that we could grow the ecosystem up within Brazil. And so those are some of the learnings that we had of delivering a neutral host, low cost network in Brazil with zero CapEx to make it easier for enterprises to consume. So we took that model and then we pivoted over to Indonesia. So moving from the fifth largest market in the world for by population to the fourth largest population for massive IoT. And it's really interesting right now, Remy, in terms of what's going on in Indonesia. They're actually rebuilding the infrastructure in Indonesia to be a powerhouse for Southeast Asia. So in the Indonesia example, we worked with the tower infrastructure company called Telkom. Partnering with Telkom gives us the access to the towers and the infrastructure we need, and then we put our software and our layers on top to deliver a resilient network. And so now I'm really happy to say that we're north of 220 cities in Indonesia, including Jakarta, Indonesia. I was just there 2 weeks ago. Population of 30 million people in an environment that reminds me a lot of Brazil. Yeah, well, it's the 10th wettest country in the world, so the type of network we put in, again, was resilient, battery backup, and solar backup to the battery backup, those kinds of things. So taking the Indonesia example, we pivoted and moved north to the United States, third largest market in the world. And so in the United States, we've been hustling the last 9 months. We've actually deployed in 550 cities across the USA. And so with that, the same notion that we had in Brazil, the same notion that we had in Indonesia is an enterprise grade, carrier grade level of network with zero CapEx. So we have a great big welcome mat in front of each one of these countries so that there's solutions partners or interesting integrators that want to open up a market without having to build out the CapEx, then this is a business model to make that extremely easy. Moving beyond the United States, we put networks in Europe, so UK, Ireland, Spain, and Italy, Andorra, and Iceland as well. Same business model that we've applied to the other countries apply to Europe, and then we've got roaming with 25 countries. So that really is the snapshot of the Everynet business model in helping kind of push LoRaWAN and push massive IoT forward.
So, very interesting. What you proved is that LoRaWAN is also a public standard, public network standard. We discussed US, Indonesia, that are large countries. And what about a giant country with a populated country that is India, maybe Ali? What it's a challenge to have one network in one giant country that is a myriad of local governments taking decisions locally. How can you manage that? Because the business model are infinite, right?
Well, I did grow a few gray hairs since I launched Senra, but it's an interesting market. We've got our network now in about 76 cities in the country. Some are just network presence to enable solution development, rollouts, discussions with municipalities on smart city projects. And then some, we've got full-blown city networks that are supporting complete water meter deployments, you know, these anchor utility applications that are providing us the connectivity. We look at the population, we put 4 gateways in Delhi and we were covering 16 million people. So it's a lot of people in India. But the mentality is a little different because telcos look at that as subscriptions to their, you know, networks. And so the price expectations can be really low from that optic if you're looking at buying a cell phone and getting a SIM card. So we had to look at ways to be able to meet the customer's needs and the expectations on pricing. Come up with some low-cost, affordable options. When we came into India, they never heard of LoRaWAN. There was Tata doing stuff, but other than that, it was really pioneering the technology there. So a lot of education, meeting with municipalities. There wasn't anything defined in regulations, so we had to work on talking to the BIS and the Department of Telecommunications, and it's just been a journey. As we wanted to be a pure network operator, we ended up becoming an end-to-end solution provider too, because even though India is some of the best coders in the world on software, making sense of sensors was a whole nother level. And so when we had our first few pilots back in 18, we didn't have anyone to reach out to that could give us a full solution to make that project a success. So we started developing our own platform, which now is being used in 60 countries around the world. And it's been an amazing journey that we've been taking.
So two characteristics of what you said, that is the DNA of LoRaWAN today. You grew the value chain, you climbed up the value chain first, and you grow the scope, you grow the geographies, you expanded. So you expanded on two dimensions, that's also a key characteristic to recall from LoRaWAN. Players start in one country and end up global. Players start with connectivity and end up with vertical application.
The one thing I want to note though, it's key to have the right partners with you. I mean, I don't think I would have taken that leap of faith of going into India if we didn't have Senet backing us from the LNS perspective. And so our public network sits on their LNS. Now we're in talks about private and on-premise installations and Actility stepping in to help us solve some of those problems. So you've got a wealth of knowledge here on this stage of projects around the world, different types of deployment methodologies, and we're just lucky to be able to tap into those resources to make us successful when we do our project.
Okay, so let's take our plane from New Delhi, go from the southeast, cross the Indian Ocean, and go to a large country, less populated. If you count animals, maybe it's equivalent to India. That is Australia. Rob will explain with NNNCo how you climb up the value chain, but also expand it globally, right? I saw you in Uruguay last week.
You did it with kangaroos and sheep. I think Ali said it about, you know, it's been a real journey. You know, we started off a clean slate, actually in 2015. We launched NNNCo at this event in Paris, so it's been a journey since then. But we started out really as a telco network operator. We got an Australian telecommunication license back then. But we did it with a little bit of a twist. We didn't have access to sites. We wanted an infrastructure company at the time. So what we did was that we partnered with large infrastructure companies that had a real thirst for IoT. And that was really, from our perspective, it was cities and utilities. And so we partnered with them and we built up these networks to support their internal use cases. So we had to also, at the same time in doing that, we had to partner really closely with solution providers that could meet those needs for those organizations. And in some cases, when those needs weren't met, we would provide those solutions ourselves, which means that we really got a deep understanding into the needs of a vertically integrated solution provider. Then we would also look for third parties to come onto that shared network infrastructure and drive a shared revenue model to obviously support NNNCo and make sure that we were sustainable, but also then provide benefits back to that infrastructure partner. So we were really joined at the hip with the large end users of the system. So then from there, we leveraged Actility as our network core, which was incredibly supportive. Again, we couldn't have really done it without Actility's support. We knew we needed a telco-grade LMS for the type of customers that we were targeting. And then from there, we started to realize that to really serve the needs of the vertically integrated solution providers, we needed to solve the integration problem. So we built a platform, an IT platform from the ground up to really help serve the needs of those solution providers. And then through those relationships, we grew into providing network capability for them globally. And it was really just a matter of picking a solution provider that had customers, not just in Australia, but also around the world. And that was really the trigger point that allowed us to grow and provide that network capability, essentially as a private network gateway, a managed network service for those solution providers.
Thank you. Let's now move to the third stage of the rocket, community networks. We had community network with the fixed network many years ago. But 2020 was probably the year of the scale. We have Joey, Helium Foundation today. Clearly, we saw this community network skyrocketing, 1 million gateway over a year in 180 countries. It's a key piece of the ecosystem to meet this pervasive coverage, right? We had a panel on satellite just 1 hour before. This is an additional piece to pervasiveness. Can you explain which problem you wanted to solve and how you would be able to scale so rapidly?
Sure. When the Helium network started, when Helium as a company started, they were pursuing opportunities to deploy wireless networks. And so they were building gateways, trying to get people to buy them, create solutions. And this was actually a protocol other than LoRaWAN at the time. So as you could imagine, they ran into a lot of challenges trying to seek adoption there. Ultimately, they started to recognize that if they could tie an incentive model to the deployment of those gateways, they could get people to buy the hardware, to make the investment, to better understand the network, and to grow networks in their area and spread it around to friends and families and offices and beyond to create a much more scalable solution. We started with basically 20,000 gateways and quickly saw adoption of those. Those were all within the United States for the most part. Very quickly recognized that there's the entire solution stack of the LoRaWAN ecosystem that can sort of augment a rollout there. And we sought out manufacturing partners to sort of help tell that story. One company can't build that many gateways. And so now we are, as you said, in 180 countries, over 66,000 cities with approaching a million gateways deployed at a rate of like 40,000 gateways a month.
Some people say that a decentralized network may have some quality of service issues, right? So it's new things coming, so adoption is always a challenge. Maybe Olivier, Actility, your job is to combine networks on a daily basis. What do we think about these different type of SLAs within the ecosystem? Is it an asset? Is it an issue?
The diversity of business models, the issue is that if you had one business model per customer, you know, the select private, all the select public, all the select community, it would be easy. Problem is that many, many use cases that actually combine all of them. If you think of tracking, the in-campus tracking, your Boeing own private LoRaWAN network, you're fine. Then you live in a city that's covered by a public network, maybe Senet, you use it, that's fine. But then tracking can literally go anywhere in the US, and that's where you realize that with that million gateway, there is hardly a place in the US where you don't have a gateway. So the question then is, how do I combine all this? And it was a big issue for a long time in the LoRa Alliance, this whole roaming. And the term roaming is very misleading. You know, if you hear roaming in the service provider world, it means moving objects and complex relationships between public service providers. In the LoRa world, forget about all this. Roaming is actually peering between anything. You can have your objects as a private company moving to Helium network or moving to Senet network or moving to NNNCo. Recently, NNNCo signed a roaming agreement, but there is one with a satellite company. And another one with, I think it's Germany, is it? Yeah, it's unlikely, right? Australia, Germany. Well, there are solution providers that need coverage in both. So very often the business case behind all these roaming needs is solution providers. You heard this always, solution providers. They design something, say a pet tracker, put it in a wholesale network, and that pet tracker will sell in Australia, or it will sell in Germany, it will sell in the US. You don't know in advance, in the middle, it's been through all of the distribution network. And that's where that global peering, for which there is a standard now, so LoRa Alliance has a standard that's supported by, I think, every network server, it's supported also by Helium. That allows you to mix and match to really realize the sum of all parts.
Okay, so maybe Dave said that you also interconnected Helium, like Actility. Can you comment on that?
Yeah, absolutely. So I think one of the things that I've seen change over the last, I don't know, 6 or 12 months, and I think the success that Helium had really showed the way for a lot, was that we need to do a better job of being collaborative, using the assets that we all bring to the market together. I think when we do that, it increases the market, as opposed to thinking about it as splitting the market amongst different folks. And I think that's, we look at that, and one of the things that we said was, you've got a million gateways in the market, I would be crazy not to take advantage of that, right? And I think earlier in the market evolution, people were going, no, that's competitive with what I'm doing, I'm afraid of that. And what we realize now, I think, as a community, is that we can support each other in these things, and it drives adoption, and it drives availability, and it makes solutions that previously were not possible, like the asset tracking across countries, possible.
Okay. So now that we've gone through all pieces of the jigsaw, we understand that, in a way, each type of network enables some types of use cases. But you know what? In the real life, we may have multiple types of use cases as an end user. So we need the glue of the jigsaw, that is the roaming. On the next slide, please. So we want to go to pervasive coverage. How? Maybe Olivier. Actility set up a global roaming hub interconnecting the four pieces of the puzzle.
The first step was obviously, as I referred to it previously, to get a standard. How do I get LP1 packets? And that standard, which was designed by the LoRa Alliance, interestingly, is not limited to LoRa. It's a standard based on anything that has an address and a payload. So if you have any type of network that works with an address and a payload, which is pretty much anything that other than voice and video, you can connect it to that peering standard. So today we have lots of satellite constellations, all this in your previous session, LEO satellite constellations. Some of them use LoRa, some others don't, but they all connect to that peering network protocol. And that's very important because
once these packets have been injected in that standard designed by the LoRa Alliance, they look like LoRaWAN packets. It means if you have designed an application, say you're using, I don't know, Microsoft IoT Central, you design an application for a specific LoRaWAN frame format, you don't need to change it. The packets coming from that layer constellation through roaming will appear like LoRaWAN packets. So that's all in place. The missing point was the hub, because as you can see, the diversity of these networks is just overwhelming. You get one big community with 1 million gateways, but on the side, you get 1 million private networks, and it's just overwhelming. So you can't mesh all this. You cannot have a network that's going to connect directly to just anybody else. Roaming hub was needed, and that's what we contributed. So we started to see universities connect to it. We instrumented at the beginning of the internet. You know, I saw this at the beginning of the internet, you know, with universities having their bubbles connecting to each other. But that's happening now over the roaming hub together with all these networks.
Okay. So, as we are running out of time, I will mix two questions in one. What would be, guys, for you the next big things, either in terms of vertical market or in the next business model to come? In the 2-3 years, how do you see it? We may have no idea.
Right.
Maybe,
maybe it's a track that actually, it may not be the big idea, but it's the next thing that we're seeing with the ESG track. So if we think about environmental social governance and the theme that Donna shared this yesterday morning about all, I think we're at the emerging stage of helping improve our planet, whether it's air quality, water, logistics, and helping companies become greener. I think we're touching it, but as far as the next massive model, I think that one has broad appeal, and I think we're just scratching the surface on the business models that can enable that.
Okay.
On our end, a million more gateways and a billion more devices, I think is the goal. We're really excited about just giving the community the authority to define where they want those gateways to go and to create the networks that they want, all while making it a shared resource. And I really approach Helium as this opportunity for a public good. And there's a lot of good that we can do with LoRaWAN devices, whether it comes to smart cities or environmental sensing or anything in the ecosystem. And so I'm excited that we've already sort of established a lot of these roaming partners where they can sort of bring people on and take advantage of that. And so I hope to see a lot more of that.
Okay, guys, thank you very much. So let's take your question now. Just the keywords. Business model diversity is not a surprise. It was from the ground up. Second, it's real. Next, LoRaWAN has a unique capability with the four pieces of the jigsaw, plus the glue with the roaming. And we start with the end of mind. We talked about ESG. We know why we are here, what we want to achieve. You know that the road can be bumpy, but we are on the way to pervasive coverage. Let me take your question, guys, if you have. So it was so clear. No questions? So I hope we shared with you the flavor of what we want to deliver to the market. We want also to highlight why kind of making a difference. We are completely open to collaborate with our standard, but when we brought to the market LoRaWAN, we wanted to bring something special, and maybe Daniel.
Yeah, just to make a final comment, I think for a lot of it's also important moment because we start seeing 5G rolling out. And I think there was a lot of buzz regarding 5G about it being a magic solution for IoT. And now that it's out there, I think the community, companies, you realize that the challenges are much above the technologies. It's about integration and all the other pieces that must be solved. So I think it's important for everyone because of this, because now We're going to have all the technologies available there, and the one we have in space. And also we'll be in the moment where the integrators will be more important than ever, because for the big scales, and it's very interesting to see what Ali just mentioned here, for the big projects, what we see is that what makes all difference, besides the real pain point that must be addressed, is someone that has the capability to put all the little pieces together, solution, device, application, integration, success, and all this, and make this in a business model that makes sense for a specific customer in a specific vertical. And there's still few companies, it's not a lot. So I think it's the key thing to enable scale, and I think it's what everybody here is looking for. So I hope for the next events we talk much more about this, and we're gonna have more examples of that.
Thank you for the conclusion. Thank you for the audience to attend late today. And we hope that you will be able to reach out to the LoRa Alliance members here to make some nice projects, to execute on the promise to solve problems that humankind has, because it's not only business. Start with the end of mind and have a fantastic evening. Thank you.